Mr. Tarrou, might want to pause and copy this page of notes. Okay, so we just got done talking about the difference between observational studies and experiments, how to, that we're going to start collecting data instead of just being given all this information to make graphs and pie charts and histograms and so on and so on. We talked about two bad ways of collecting data. That would be voluntary response settings, where you just pose a question to the entire population and let whoever wants to respond, respond, like on TV, or excuse me, on the internet or call-in surveys. We also talked about convenient sampling, which is also not a good way to collect data, through a sample, and then did some proper techniques like simple random sample, stratified random sample, cluster sampling, and multi-stage sampling. Well, now I want to give you some cautions about these sample surveys that we're attempting to do to collect data. This idea of undercoverage, which occurs when some groups in the population are left out of the process of choosing a sample. Nowadays, where I live, a lot of people are starting to abandon their landlines, their hard landlines, for the use of the cell phones exclusively. So if I want to do a phone survey, and all I do is pick up a phone book and start calling phone numbers, then I'm undercovering the people that only use cell phones. Now, if the people that use cell phones are the same as the people that use just landlines, then that really may not cause a problem with my survey. But if there's a difference between those populations of people that tend to use cell phones, tend to be younger and more mobile than those that use exclusively landlines, or both, cell phone and landlines, then that undercoverage may cause my sample to be biased because I'm leaving out a part of the population that would give a different response to my question, if that's pertinent, because, you know, we are trying to learn about a part of a population with our sample, and if that difference is not important, then it won't be, but if there is a difference, if it is important to your survey, then that could be under coverage, that would be a problem. Non-response occurs when individuals chosen for the sample can't be contacted or refuse to cooperate. Though we voluntarily choose to take part in a sample or a survey, this is not the same as voluntary response because we were contacted individually. No one can force us to answer questions in a sample or a survey. No one can force us to be in an experiment, not that we're discussing experiments at the moment. So there's always this idea of voluntarily being a part of whatever this survey or sample is, if you're contacted, of course, to be in the survey yourself. This is not the same as voluntary response. Remember, voluntary response is the newspaper saying write in, or write your congressman, or the TV personality going, hey, get online and vote on our online poll to give us your opinions, where they just blanket the entire population with one request for responses. That's voluntary response. We find it much easier to complain, unfortunately, than it is to compliment. If we're happy and content, we don't make a lot of noise. So voluntary response settings generally tend to be negatively biased, as talked about in the last video. Non-response is you get contacted individually and for some reason you refuse. If you can identify a part of the population, you as a statistician, if you can identify a part of the population that has a much higher non-response rate, you can resample just that part of the population to try and fill in the gap. If you're doing a sample survey and you notice that large businesses tend to return your request or answer your questions less often than small business, then you could do a small SRS of just large businesses to try and fill in that gap in your data from all the non-response. If you're sampling people in different regions like rural areas in the country, suburban areas, or big cities, if you notice that you want a sample that represents all three of those groups and you notice a lot of people in the city say, hey, go buzz off, then that high non-response in just the city areas would cause an issue with your sample and cause it possibly to be biased and not represent the population. So you could do a small SRS of just the large city people, dwellers, to try and pull in some more of those responses to fill in the gap. So there are ways to sometimes deal with non-response. And then other times, you know, there's always going to be non-response in every sample survey. It's just, you know, something we have to deal with, and you know, it can never be removed completely. So undercoverage, you leave people out. Non-response, those people are choosing to not respond. That's always going to happen. But if there is an area of your population, an area of your sample that has a much, much higher non-response rate, you are allowed to go back and do a small SRS to try and fill in that gap with just that part of the population. Woo! Okie dokie. I talked about this in my last video a little bit, but you can have bias in a survey from a poorly designed survey. If I want to see what percent of people at home bake and I just call people at home during the daytime hours, maybe I get a higher proportion of people saying they bake as opposed to if I called in the morning, in the afternoon, and late evening, possibly catching more people that work in the early morning and the late evening. So I can have bias in response in my survey, my sample, from a poorly designed sample. I can have bias from behavior of the interviewer, embarrassment about the true answer, so they lie, race or sex of the interviewer, or faulty memory about the long past events. You know, if somebody comes to my door, that is a minority, and starts asking me racially sensitive questions, you know, I might be embarrassed or not want to answer honestly about those questions. If some nuns and priests come through the neighborhood and they're finding out they're doing some kind of survey about their church and religion, I might be a little bit more pressured to say something about positive about religion because these people are, you know, to be respectful because they're priests or nuns. If you come to me and you ask about, you know, whether I do drugs or drink a lot, those might not be questions that I want to answer someone face to face with, so I'd be embarrassed, so I might lie and underestimate or just say, no, I don't drink, or no, I don't do any drugs, or, you know, if you embarrass somebody, you're not going to get an honest answer out of them face to face unless something's set up to allow them to sort of answer anonymously about questions that may be embarrassing. You can have wording bias. When the question includes leading information, making one response more likely. Again, if I said, you know, some expert says blah, 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 how do you feel about it? Well, you might be more inclined to agree with the expert's opinion that I gave you even before I started asking the question. So your wording bias can be an issue and give you faulty responses. There was I don't remember if it was in my book or something I read online, but there was a scenario where they were testing whether or not, you know, people preferred Coke or Pepsi. Well, that's kind of, not really, that's still a sample survey. Where they gave them, they said, okay, here's cup A, here's cup B, taste them and tell us which one you prefer. Well, they did not randomize what order people drank the sodas, and so it became biased simply because they more often chose the last taste they had in their mouth, or something like that, where they didn't randomize the order in which the soda was drank, so the results came out to be faulty. So that was bias that was not from response bias, it was not from wording of the question, it was just simply no randomization in the process of the sample. And then we have this idea of inference. This is a huge concept. And inferencing is what statistics is all about. We take small samples, we analyze that sample, we draw conclusions, and then we sort of inference that or make a conclusion about the entire population based on what we saw in the sample. So an inference of the population is making conclusions about the population from a sample. These samples are only estimates and have variations in their results. If 40% of the people in a local area shop at a certain grocery store, if I go ask 100 people, hey, do you shop at store X? You're not going to get exactly 40%. You're going to get around 40% because you're only sampling a small portion of the population. And not quite a survey, but even if you're just flipping a coin, you are going to probably not get the same results twice. This variability is what makes sampling distributions whose mean is sample mean or proportion. Like when you flip a coin, let's talk about flipping a coin for a second. You know, if a coin is fair, it's perfectly balanced, you're going to get heads in the long run 50% of the time. Well, if you flip a coin twice, it's not unlikely that you would get heads two times in a row or 100% of the time. That's certainly not 50-50. Even if you flip a coin 50 times, you're not going to get an exactly 25 heads and 25 tails. You're going to get around 50% heads and tails. That variability is what makes sampling distribution something we'll talk a lot more about later. So the mean of your sample or the mean proportion, this would be like you flipping a coin 20 times and recording the percent of times you got heads, is, if unbiased, be equal to the population mean, sample mean, population mean, sample proportion, population proportion, if the sample is unbiased. So what that means is if 40% of people in a certain local area shop at a store and you survey 100 people, you are not going to get exactly 40%. Well, you could, but it's unlikely. However, if you repeated that sampling, which is not necessarily a good idea in statistics, but as far as the idea of sampling distributions goes, if you were to continually sample unbiasedly 100 people in that area over and over and over and over and over again, and then take your results and make a histogram out of it, it will be centered around the 0.4, 40% of the population. I should be pointing to the P. If 40% of the population shop at that store, then your sample results will center around 0.4 if it is unbiased. Okay? You flip a coin. If you flip a coin 20 times, you are not going to get heads 50% of the time, every single time. But if you flip that coin 20 times, record the percent of heads. Flip the coin 20 times, record the percent of heads. Flip the coin 20 times, record the percent of heads, and so on, and repeat that process many, 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 many times, and then make a histogram out of all those proportions that you observed out of the 20 flips. That sampling distribution will center around the true 0.5 if the coin is indeed fair. Okay, one more screen and we're done for this morning. Statements as we go through the year, but as an introductory statement, larger samples have less variability and thus are more accurate. But it is possible for a survey or an experiment to actually be too accurate. If you're doing quality control at the end of an assembly line, if you do such a large sample that, let's say we're filling soda bottles, if you take such a large sample that you can tell that the soda bottles are being filled, let's say if it's off by more than half an ounce, and you stop the lines, and you go, well, all right, okay, something's wrong with the machine, we're under or overfilling the bottles by half an ounce, stop the presses and change and make some adjustments. Well, if the boss goes, I can only make adjustments on 1 ounce increments, then you've made a test that's too sensitive. You're telling them that it's off by a half an ounce, but it has no real life application. Adjustment can't be made that small. I'm sure it probably could be, but the point is you can reduce the variability to such a degree that you get statistically significant results. Not that you quite know what that means yet, but you can, you know, put your hands up and go, oh, something's weird, something's changing, and yet there has no real life application. It's too sensitive. And as long as the population is at least 10 times greater than the sample size, you'll be using that phrase a lot this year, it is only the size of the sample that determines the variability of that sample. So I'm recording these videos in Florida. If I take a sample of 500 voters and say, okay, in Florida, make a conclusion. If I take a sample of 500 people for the entire United States and draw a conclusion, those two samples have the same variability because they both have a sample size of 500, even though the state of Florida as a population is much, much smaller than the entire U.S. So, if the populations are greater than 10 times the sample size, it is only the size of the sample that determines the variability of the sample. You'll notice that when you look at all your standard deviation formulas for all the different types of variables we're going to learn, but that is a much later and a much longer discussion. Woo! Mr. True, thank you for watching these videos. I'm hoping they're helping. Go do your homework, read your book.